Well, the four noble truths are the basic teachings of Buddhism, and you can find these four noble truths in all schools of Buddhism. And basically, the four noble truths are about suffering or dukkha. And sometimes we don't want to translate the word dukkha as suffering, because the term dukkha, the meaning of the term dukkha, has something more than that. So we simply say dukkha is dukkha. Dukkha is the state of being depressed. So this is the first truth. And then the second one is samudaya. So samudaya is the cause of pain or the cause of suffering. And then number three, nirodha. Nirodha means extinction of suffering or the end of suffering. And last one, magga, the part leading to the extinction of suffering. So these four noble truths were taught by the Buddha from the very beginning of his mission as the Buddha. And even in his first sermon, the Buddha mentioned about the four noble truths because he wanted to show to the world that this is the way life is. So life has a problem, life has suffering, and then there must be the cause of that suffering. That is called craving or tanha. And then he also offered the way, or he also confirmed that there is the solution. What is the solution? Nirodha, or extinction of suffering. And how to achieve that solution, we need to put it into the practice, what we call magga, or the path leading to the extinction of suffering. Well, for lay people or for ordinary people, we normally begin with dana, giving, so dana, and then sila, being moral or morality, and then bhavana, mental development. And these are the three steps that will lead you to the end of suffering. But for the monk, and we normally begin with sila, yeah, sila means a morality or precepts, and then samadhi, concentration, and last one, panya, or wisdom. And when you apply these three principles in your daily life or in your practice, and then day by day you're able to eradicate or reduce the degree of greed, hatred, or delusion. Because from the Buddhist point of view, greed, hatred, and delusion are the root of evil things, of evil action. Whenever you're able to reduce greed, hatred, delusion, then you're able to achieve enlightenment in the future. Well, from the Buddhist point of view, and the Buddha did not actually teach suffering as the way of pessimistic or negative aspect, but he just wanted to point out this is the way life is. So, and Buddhism is criticized by many scholars for being a pessimistic or negative religion. But from the Buddhist point of view, the Buddha's teaching is realistic. We focus on the truth, on the reality, because we need to understand this is the way life is. And he did not actually emphasize on suffering that much, but he just wanted to point out this is suffering, and then he offered the way to end that suffering. And if you look at the story of the Buddha before he left the palace, he saw four sights: old man, sick man, dead man, and an ascetic monk. Having seen the three sights, he thought, why we have to grow old, why we have to get sick, and why we have to die. There must be the solution to these problems. There must be the way to stop these sufferings. So he decided to leave the palace in order to find the answer. For about 6 years, he practiced meditation until he discovered by himself that whenever you're able to eradicate the cause of birth, and then you will be no longer reborn. When you are no longer reborn, then there will be no old age, illness, and don't know that. So this is from the Buddhist point of view. Well, intention is important because we have an intention first arising in the mind. But we do not only judge from the intention, although you have a good intention, but it doesn't mean that you will be escaped from being criticized or blamed. For example, as a doctor, you have a good intention to help the patient, but you may make some mistake. Your intention is good, but you make a mistake, and that patient died. So this doesn't mean that the doctor should not be blamed, and he should be blamed for his mistake, but he shouldn't be blamed for his intention. So we do not look from one angle. We will look at intention and the consequence as well. Well, first, I just would like to make it clear when we translate the word anatta, and this is in Pali language, and many scholars translate it as no self, and many Buddhist scholars simply like to translate not self, not non-self. I prefer the second translation. You know why? Because when I look at the discourse given by the Buddha, Anatta Lakkhana Sutta, when he said, Rūpaṁ anatta, matter or rūpa is not self. And then he further gave an explanation. If this rūpa, if this body is atta, is yours, then you can control it. So what I'm going to say is that when we say anatta, I like to translate as not self, not no self. Yeah? For example, body is not yours. If body is yours, and then you can control your body, feeling is not yours, and if the feeling is yours, and then you are able to control your feeling. The explanation of anatta, or not self, can be explained in different way. For example, when we look at the body, the human body is the combination of five aggregates. You may have the term skanta or kanta. So there are five skantas or five kantas or five aggregates. Rupa kanta, body. Vedana kanta, feeling. Sanya kanta, mental perception. Sankhara, mental formation. And vijnana, consciousness. So these five skandhas or aggregates are the combination of human body. When we separate, when we analyze the human body into the five aggregates, and then we are not able to see as a human being. When you put the aggregate of body over there, put the aggregate of feeling over here, you won't see a person as a person. Another example. When we look at the car, when you look at the car, you see it as a car. But when you separate the cars into different parts, the wheel, the body, the gas or whatever, and then we will be no longer able to see that as a car, because it's just the car parts. Even the paper, before it becomes a paper, it must be a tree, or before it was a tree, it must be something else. When we burn the paper, it will be no longer a paper, it's just an arches. So when these arches scatter into the ground, then you won't be able to see it as an arches. So this is the explanation of anatta. There is no real essence in itself. Well, the concept of impermanent is, the first of the three characteristics of existence: anicca, dukkhaṃ and anatta. Anicchaṃ or impermanence is important for Buddhist philosophy because this is the truth that we have to understand and accept. And we can see impermanence even in our daily life. And before we were young, we were kids, we were children, and then we became teenage, and then we grow up as a young man. And in the next 20 years or 40 years, we will become an old people. And even now, it is an autumn, you can see the falling of the tree leaf. That may reflect impermanence, and this impermanence can tell us this is the way things are. So we shouldn't attach things too much, because attachment will bring us suffering. If we have less attachment, then we will have less suffering. Meditation is the way to train the mind. When we use the term meditation, from the Buddhist point of view, perhaps the term meditation is not right. But now, because this word is widely used, we prefer to use the term like a mental development or mental exercise, because when we look at the dictionary of the definition of the word meditation, it would be like to keep thinking about something or to ponder. But in Buddhism, we do not simply concentrate the mind on one thing, or we do not keep thinking, or we do not ponder, but we apply mindfulness to any action, verbal action, physical action, and even mental action. So as I said, meditation is the way to train the mind. Buddhism believes that mind is the source of happiness and unhappiness. When the mind is well trained, then happiness is expected. So if the mind is not well trained, there will be lots of trouble, suffering. This is the reason why that Buddhism focuses on the mental training or the mind training. That is what we call meditation. But many people do not understand what meditation is really about. They thought to meditate, they must be able to keep the mind concentrated on one thing all the time. And that is incorrect. Yes, I say that is incorrect. And because they do not actually understand what meditation is. So first, they need to understand what meditation is about. Meditation is the way to train the mind. And when they have lots of distraction can be taken as meditation object. You can observe distraction as meditation object. And whenever you are sleepy, when you are tired, you can even observe. In our daily life, I usually advise the people to apply mindfulness in their daily life, whatever they do. When they walk, try to be mindful of their step. When they're driving, try to be mindful of their driving. When they have to stop at the traffic light, that's a good time to regain mindfulness. So, as you see, meditation can be done in our daily life. It's not necessary to sit still. Meditation does not start in the room. It doesn't end in the meditation room either. Meditation can be done in every moment. It depends how you apply mindfulness at that moment. Well, I do not like to use the word fate because we don't have this word in Buddhism, fate. Yeah? We have confidence. In Pali, satta. Yeah? We call it satta. Satta means confidence. But this confidence must be accompanied by wisdom or investigation. So we do not simply believe, because, this is taught by our teacher. Even the Buddha, he asked the monk to investigate his teaching. Whenever you see it by yourself, whenever you see the result by yourself, and then you choose to believe in it. At first, when the monks listened to the Buddha's teaching, the Buddha said, Don't believe everything I said. Put it into your practice. When you see the result by yourself, and then that's your choice. That's up to you. Well, many people still misunderstand that Buddhism denies God. This is wrong. And if you look at the Buddhist text, there is nowhere in the Buddhist text that the Buddha denied the existence of God. Buddhism believes in God, but the concept of God is different from other religions, like from a theistic religion. So God, from the Buddhist point of view, is like a human being. We have many gods. In the trees, there is God, the river, there is God, even underneath the earth, there is God, the goddess of earth. But those gods are not like the creator God, because they are still traveling in the cycle of birth and death. They can't escape from old age, illness and death like all of us. So one day, they may be reborn as a human being, but now they are born as God. And like in heaven, yes, we have divine beings, and we call them sometimes gods. G-O-D-S, gods, with small letter. So gods, from the Buddhist point of view, are not like a creator God. And sometimes we respect them because of their good deeds, because of their good action, then they were reborn as the divine being or as a god. Well, being born as a human being, you have a good opportunity to accumulate perfection. Because in the human realm, there are poor and rich. Yeah? There are poverty. So that may give you a chance to cultivate goodness, like to cultivate the dana or the nation. But if you were born as a god, because you are in the same level, everyone is equal, no one is poor, no one is rich, they are equal. But in the human world, we can see everything. So as human beings, we have many advantages. We can see suffering, we can be ordained as a monk in order to train ourselves, and then we are able to cultivate perfection. What I mean by perfection is like the perfection of generosity, the perfection of truthfulness. Before the Buddha attained his enlightenment, he had cultivated 10 perfections. And when these 10 perfections were fulfilled, and then he attained enlightenment. So he could do this only when he was born as a human being. Well, the word enlightenment is a translation of the Pali term Sammasambuddha. Yes, Sammasambuddha. Buddha is derived from the root Buddhi. Buddhi simply means knowledge. So the root of the word Buddha is Buddhi, which means knowledge. So when you truly understand everything, when you truly understand, this is the way things are. And then you understand the cause and condition. When we look at the term Sammasambuddha, we can say Samma, fully, Sambuddha, enlightened. We even translate that as to be awakened. Awakened from sleepiness, awakened from ignorance. So this means that the Buddha realized the Four Noble Truths. He understood life has suffering. He understood that life and suffering has its cause. And then he understood that there is the solution. In order to reach that solution, we must find the way to achieve that solution. That is what we call Makka. So in conclusion, when a person attains enlightenment, this means that that person truly understands the Four Noble Truths. Well, the idea that Buddhism was split into Theravada and Mahayana is in fact from the interpretation of the monastic codes, not the teaching. So the split was based on the understanding of the Vinaya or monastic rules. When we look at the core teachings, we are not much different. And I recently have the connection with Tibetan Buddhist monks. When I look at their monastic rules, they're not much different. They actually have the same rule. But the thing is, they just try to focus on the important ones. In Theravada tradition, we focus on wisdom. Before you can help yourself, you need to help yourself first. I can give you the example. If you can't swim, how come you can help a person who's drunk? You can't. But in Mahayana tradition, they said, it is your duty to help everyone. So they focus on compassion. So compassion is the emphasis of Mahayana Buddhism. Wisdom is the emphasis of Theravada Buddhism. But when we look at the core teaching, we're not much different. So both schools still teach the Four Noble Truths, and both schools still observe the similar monastic codes. Well, Dhammapada is the collection of the Buddha words, or the verse of wisdom. Dhammapada is the collection of, as I said, the Buddha words. It may give you some insight, or it may shed light on what you have learned already. Dhammapada may be a good starting point for those who are very new to Buddhism, because the contents are not very complicated. And you can read the Buddha stanza or the words of wisdom given by the Buddha. And then you may understand those words immediately. But for those who would like to go through more profound teaching, I would recommend you to begin with reading the text, or maybe begin with the story of the Buddha, or introduction to Buddhism, or basic Buddhism. And now the information on Buddhism is available online. It's very, very easy to get access to online. I normally visit accesstoinsight.org, accesstoinsight.org, because in that website, a lot of Buddhist texts have been translated into English. So this may be, for me, this may be the best source for English-speaking people who would like to find more about Buddhism. Well, when we bow, we show respect to the Buddha. And though there is no Buddha statue, when we bow, we show respect. By bowing, you let go your eagerness. Yeah, but you let go your eagerness. For Buddhists, they normally use candles, 3 incense sticks, and flowers as an offering. Candles are presenting the Buddha's teaching, in the sense that candles give us the light, like the teachings give us an advice. At night, we need the light. In life, we need an advice or the teaching. And the 3 incense sticks are presenting the 3 virtues of the Buddha: compassion, purity, and wisdom. In fact, everyone can have these virtues: compassion, purity, and wisdom. And last one, flowers are presenting the harmony and the unity. So the commentator gave further explanation that By using flower, it may symbolize the harmony and the unity of the community. These will be like flowers are from different places, maybe in different size or in different color. And when they are in the same vase, they look beautiful. Like when people are united, when people follow the same teaching, they are united and they look beautiful. Well, I would like to tell them to look at their own life, to take a close look at the meaning of their life. Why we live for? What is the meaning of life? And if we pay attention too much to the material thing, because the material things are always changing, when things are changing, your happiness is always changing. And if they have time, they may try to learn meditation, because meditation, we help them to keep focus on whatever they are doing. Meditation can help them to stay at the now or to focus on the now. When you are at the present moment, you won't be disturbed by worrying or anxiety. And even those who have trouble with anxiety or stress, they can observe it, acknowledge it. Stress or anxiety comes and goes. So this reflects the teachings of impermanence. It comes and goes, and they do not disappear because you still cling them, you still hold them. And if you know how to let them go, and then they will be no longer bring you trouble or suffering. I would like to give you the example, like you happen to catch the fish under the river. You are not sure yet if it is a fish or a snake, a poisonous snake. Whenever you sit by yourself, it is a poisonous snake. Without hesitation, you will throw that snake away. So what I'm going to say is that as long as we don't see the danger of attachment or clinging, then we still attach to them. We still cling on to them. The thing is, we need to learn step by step. Let go bit by bit, and then we will find inner peace or happiness. Well, the term reincarnation may have different meanings. I prefer to use the word rebirth rather than reincarnation. From my understanding, to be reincarnated means that you will come back as the same person. But from the Buddhist point of view, you won't come back as the same person. Because of your bad deeds, you may be born as an animal. Because of your good deeds, you may be born in heaven as an angel. Well, the concept of rebirth can be explained in the modern way. Every moment, every minute, we were reborn. Yes, for example, if you are greedy, from the Buddhist point of view, you are born as a hungry ghost. And if you are angry, you are already in hell, because hell and heaven can be experienced here and now. However, Buddhism also believes in life after death. So when a person dies, the person will be reborn immediately. But to be reborn as what depends on their action. It doesn't depend on what they believe. Although you're a Buddhist, it doesn't guarantee that you will be born as a human being or in the heaven. It depends on your action, on your deeds. So your deeds will lead you either to hell or to heaven. Another example, mind is an energy. When only the body decays, when this body dies, the mind is like an energy. This may be like a bow. When the bow is damaged, you replace it with a new one, and then the life is back. So the mind is like that. And the mind is an energy. You can't see, you can't explain how the mind is like, because it is an energy. Well, when I visit a dying person, either as a hospital or at a hospice, I always comfort them, explain to them that they should not worry too much about the people behind. And if they are going to die, they choose to die peacefully. I also tell their relative not to show the sadness in front of the dying person, because that doesn't help. That doesn't help. It will make things worse. Because and if you show your grief or sadness, especially when you're crying, when someone is going to die, that may upset the dying person. When the dying person is upset, it's not good for them. It's not good for them to be reborn in the good planet. For the dying person, I normally tell them to remind of any kinds of good deeds that they have done during their lifetime. Yes, for example, and if they can remind of their donation, or meditation practice, or observing precepts, I remind them of their good deeds. When the dying person can think of their good deeds, and then they might be peaceful. When they are about to die, they would die peacefully. If they die peacefully, good birth is expected.